share the Senate priorities for the Senate Democrat caucus. This is a budget here. And our top goal is to invest in Hoosiers so that we have an economy that works for everyone, not just businesses. We want to make sure families have the services and support they need to be successful. That we're investing in young people so that they stay in our state and thrive. And that everyone feels like they're welcome and that their rights will not be under constant threat in Indiana. I wholeheartedly believe that if we can focus this session on investing in Hoosiers and put a halt to all the divisive cultural wars that we've had, and we see churning right now in the Indiana General Assembly, we can do great works for Hoosiers this session. Now I'd like to pass it to one of my colleagues, Senator Melton, to discuss a few of our funding priorities.
Senator Taylor is right that we should be going into this budget year with a mindset to invest heavily in our residents. After seeing an inborn and unexpected revenue over the course of the fiscal year, Indiana is in a strong fiscal financial position. Our business community is thriving and continue to remain at a AAA bond rating. It's time to spread the wealth to residents and make bold investments that we know, that we all know, will provide support to families. We need to make investments that allow Hoosier families, new mothers, new couples, and college students, and graduates to thrive in the state.
Yeah.
My caucus, we are encouraged to hear from the governor's investment in his budget for K-12. But that must be every single caucus in this chamber as well as in the other chambers. Adequately funding K-12 and supporting teacher pay and staff pay raises must always be the number one goal of the legislature. Especially when we know we have a shortage of teachers, counselors, nurses, and staff across the board. We will not thrive as a state until we address our teacher shortage. Yes, it is critical. And we must make sure we're investing adequately and equitably. And I echo that again, I said in equitably in K-12 this session to support our schools and students and to retain and attract the educators we need. My caucus was also excited to hear the governor's mention of eliminating textbook fees as a session priority. That's a major accomplishment that we will accomplish this session. And I also want to make sure that you are aware that the Senate Democratic Caucus have carried this for a number of years. I believe this is Senator Gene Grove. State House Democrats have been constantly involved in these types of issues. Our caucus will be offering legislation again this session to meet this done to ensure parents are no longer struggling under the burden their children's textbook fees. The governor also voiced his support for the automatic enrollment of students in the 21st Century Scholars Program. This is something that is going to help every single university. We know that the state of Indiana, many of our colleges and institutions have seen a decline in enrollment. So this program will help those families, will help those children access higher education and help our institutions. Automatic enrollment in this program will mean putting more Indiana students on the path to higher educational attainment. This would expand opportunities to more students, bolster our workforce, attract higher paying jobs, skilled jobs, and create an economy that works for our residents and keep them here instead of driving them to other states. Although this program was not included in the governor's budget, I will have a bill to address that. I'm urging our colleagues to support us as we try to get this accomplished this session. And I want to thank the Commission of Higher Ed for agreeing that this is a very important issue and opportunity for us to address. Thank the Commission for that. This session, as I close, we have the ability to make bold investments and policy advancements to dramatically reshape and bolster our economy for residents. And I hope we don't let this opportunity pass us by. So again, I want to thank you all, and I pass this opportunity to my colleague, Senator Shelby.
Each session marks a new opportunity to do good for Hoosier families, an opportunity to build an Indiana that rewards hard work, that embraces diversity, our students' AWIN tests and reading scores. There is a partial fix to all of these issues. Child care. We are a state of child care deserts. None of our 92 counties have sufficient toddler care. More than three quarters of counties have less than 25% of the capacity they need. And even when child care is available, it is not in reach for many Hoosier families. Reports show that the average Hoosier family spends 12% of their income on child care, half of that, 7%. With prices of mortgages, property taxes, rent, education, medicine, and even food rising, and a stagnant $7.25 minimum wage, how is an average family supposed to make ends meet? Data shows that high-quality early learning and child care programs improve educational outcomes, which is desperately needed in a state where 20% of our students are not reading at the recommended level by third grade. Child care is a workforce issue as well. As well as an education issue. Indiana businesses cite lack of child care as their biggest external workforce barrier. There are so many parents who need and want to work to support their families, to provide for their children, but can't because they're unable to find a trustworthy or affordable option to care for their child. Child care is basic. Not only that, it's necessary for many teachers. It's vital for our economy, to our students' educational experiences, and to hardworking citizens across the state. Another top issue for Senate Democrats goes hand in hand with child care, and that is paid family leave. Paid family leave provides time for new parents to bond with their newborn and provide important health benefits. As a state with the third highest maternal mortality rate, we need to be trying anything and everything to deliver better outcomes for pregnant women and mothers. Paid leave is shown to lead to better maternal or in some cases, restore freedoms that were taken. On the first day of session, our caucus wanted to take the opportunity to emphatically reaffirm our commitment to Hoosiers' independence, privacy, and choice. Hoosiers deserve autonomy over their own bodies. Hoosiers deserve privacy in their most intimate healthcare decisions. Hoosiers deserve to choose who they love, who they marry, and who they start a family with. We'll be working to make sure that Hoosiers have that freedom to build the lives that they want to build without interference from their elected government officials. Today, I filed a bill that would restore abortion access up to 20 weeks. This allows this legislature the opportunity to course correct if the Supreme Court allows SB1 to stand. When we take away our citizens' autonomy and create ambiguity and fear among our health care providers, we drive them out of the state. We drive them to places like Illinois, where they know that the building blocks of their lives and or their professional practice are respected and highly
rights of our citizens. People don't want to live in a state where they feel like their voices, the voices of residents, are ignored, and where rights like women's rights to access reproductive health care are not safe. That's why we'll focus on restoring Roe, as Senator Yoder said, and on protecting same-sex marriage and interracial marriage. We all know that we have someone who has already filed intent to run for governor, who believes that the states should have their own laws about interracial and same-sex marriage. On the national level, we see President Biden pass the Respect for Marriage Act into law, but in Indiana, a ban on same-sex marriage still exists. When we talked about the brain drain, or look at our shortage of teachers and staff and healthcare professionals, OBGYNs, and care providers, our shortage of work, capital across the board, we can thank Indiana's policies, which go directly against what the people of Indiana want. And for that, recent polls from Ball State's annual Hoosier survey show that nearly 60% of Hoosiers believe abortion should be legal in all or most cases. Over 85% of the Hoosiers support marijuana legislation in some form. And 50% of those believe it should be for personal use. Yet, despite all these views by Hoosiers, I'm concerned based off past trends that we will still be going to fail to get these policies passed that Hoosiers want to see. Policies that support freedoms for residents in other states, including many of our neighboring states that have already enjoyed these privileges. Indiana will not move forward, even with all the business attraction that we want to do, will not attract new higher paying jobs. We will not retain young minds and keep workers in our state if this General Assembly keeps focusing its energy on cultural wars that threaten the citizens' rights instead of investing in things like K-16 education. I challenge them to put that to a test. And how do we do it? Across the country, citizens got to have a say on issues like abortions being banned, marijuana being legalized, and our residents deserve the same rights as those residents in other states. All my bill would do would allow us is to create I know they rolled out their agenda today, and their priorities were fiscal responsibility, improving mental health infrastructure, and lowering health care costs. They also discussed supporting law enforcement and protecting user data. That's okay, and it's a good start, and I think we should go there. But nowhere near close to what we should or could do for residents as we start this session with record reserves. We must prioritize users and their families and the future of our students in the state and the freedoms that every person that lives here would like to come to Indiana and stay. We'll open it up to questions if you have any specific to a legislator or
anything of the Democratic agenda to provide boosters with any sort of property tax relief this year, because we saw the assessments went up through the roof last year. We're not quite sure what's going to do for property taxes this year.
I find it interesting about the property tax discussion, because we all know property taxes go to fund municipal governments, not state government. So if we're going to change the power policies or even lower property taxes, that means the state of Indiana should be willing to step in and fill in the gap. What I do find interesting, though, is that when I came in the legislature, when we were just determining whether or not we put the 1, 2, 3 property tax caps into the Constitution, is that their own Senator Holman today, when asked a question by one of your reporters, didn't answer the question that was asked, which is, would that mean reversing some of the property tax cap legislation that's in the Constitution of the state of Indiana? I don't think they have the, the fortitude to go back to Hoosiers and say, hey, now we want to take those caps away. So I'm just interested to see what their ideas are. And no, we do not want to effectively mess with the budgets of the municipal government by changing property taxes.
If I can add to that, I think one of our caucus members may have some legislation.
The governor's the public health commission proposal that closely uses the department of administration kind of as an opt-in to the local health department, so if they only get the money if they do provide services. There's a broad expectation that not everybody is going to opt in right away. So to that point, the governor's sort of proposing a step up in funding in this budget and then even the next budget, presumably, where they would eventually get their full funding. Is that the right way to go about? Should we do this gradually because we know not everybody's going to jump in up with you?
Yeah, I'll try to start with that real quickly. We know we had a report, we know that Dr. Box and Senator Forrest and Senator McKinley for statewide group together. We know how low policy the rate on Medicaid reimbursement rate is in the federal government. So I think we've all heard from our local health departments and district things. Now, this is their legislation, meaning that this is the local caucus legislation, so I don't want to speak on behalf of them and what they had or should have done. But I would say that we have a firm belief that if we want to be active across the board, we do know that there are about three or four standalone county health departments that are not included in the overall makeup of those four municipal county health. So I'm keeping a watchful eye to make sure that that's taken care of and they're not overlooked taking place. So with that being said, I'm hopeful that we'll be able to work with Senator Charlotte.
I've always been one of those people that believe, and as an attorney, that believes that bail has become this way of taking care of the people who have a lot and actually penalizing the people who have little. And that's not what our government is about. I was shocked to actually hear we've seen over the history of any type of public policy that has these types of subjective criteria, people who look like me seem to be on the bottom end of the scale. So I'm interested. I think serving on judiciary and the Criminal Corrections and Criminal Code Committee, I think it'll come along. I'm interested in the discussion about what he means by a danger to society and letting people out on bail. You know, it's kind of interesting that we're focused on bail when it comes to crime, but we're not focusing on, in my opinion, the public policy decisions like decriminalization of marijuana that would lower the incarceration rate for a lot of people who look like me, and we're still talking about bail. Some people go to jail for the first time for possession of marijuana and end up in a lifetime of criminal activity. So I find it ironic right here.
Question for Senator Yoder. On the, this is kind of a two-part question. On the child care proposal you were putting forth, first of all, do you have a dollar amount for what you're kind of looking for there in the budget? And then second, see this basically calling out Republicans saying, hey, you guys said that you were going to expand child care funding as part of this abortion thing, now put your money where your mouth is?
Yes, put your money where your mouth is a great way to respond. What I would like to see is child care and dependent care tax credits put the money back into the pockets of hardworking teachers and let them have the relief. That's what I'm looking to see. That's the legislation that I filed. And we got traction in previous sessions. I know that the chamber was supportive. I know my local chamber is absolutely supportive. So that would be the direction that would be an easy way to help give some relief to families, inflation relief to families across this future state, as well as response to some of these child care deserts that we're seeing across the state.
How does that solve the problem, though? You know, you can give people the money or to pay for child care, but the system doesn't have capacity for everybody to use child care. So how do you address that?
It is a complicated issue, and I would hope that increased competition, increased support for child care, if families can pay for it, then maybe there would be more people participating in the need of child care and increasing the child care in need. Competitively addressed. We could try that. This legislature has heard this before, but we haven't even tried that. Let's try something. Instead of just a task force, let's put a policy in place, and this would be done way better.
Indiana is obviously not a healthy state. That's something Democrats and Republicans can agree upon, especially with this health commission and everything like that. So, you know, you guys want a different amount of funding than the Republicans do, but the way that they're proposing the bill is to basically give a suggestion on how to use the money, and then these local affiliates can kind of, like, you know, opt into it. Do you think that that needs to be more direct, as in, here's the money, here's what you need to do with it to create these programs for specifically rural communities and even urban communities that don't have access to the same amount of health care as you might be in America?
I think that's definitely my approach. If I'm understanding your question, is
so basically, like, the way that I understood it is that they're going to have this money that they're going to give to local health departments if they can opt into or not opt into it, and then they'll give them suggestions on how to use it if they opt into it. Do you think it should be they have the money here, should they be able to opt into it or opt out?
It's hard to speak, and I will present anything, but we know that Indiana struggles when it comes to tobacco use. We know that our infant mortality rates and our infant fatality rates are inhumane.
Let me start by saying the governor mentioned it in his budget, but notice that my colleagues on the other side of the aisle didn't mention it in their budget, which gives me some cause for concern as to the price tag for that education funding, K-12 education funding. I'd like to give you guys a little bit of information about one of the largest school districts in the state of Indiana and what they've seen from a K-12 education funding standpoint, and that is Indianapolis Public Schools, which educates almost 31,000 students in the state of Indiana. In 2010, their foundation, state support from the foundation was $7,367. Let me repeat that. $7,367 in 2010-11. Today, 10 to 12 years later, in the 2022-23 budget proposal, our budget that we just finished, it's $7,699. That's a 6% increase. While we've seen over the last, that same period of time, a 21% increase in K-12 funding from the state. I want you to think about that from the perspective of one of the largest school districts in K-12 educating one of the highest population. I think they might trail Allen County a little bit, but approximately 31,000 kids. While the budget has gone up 21%, and we talk about this reinvestment in the other side of the aisle talks about, you can see where our priorities lie by where we spend our money, over 51% of our budget. But when you look at the details, you will see that their priorities have been, for example, 110 times increase in vouchers assistance. Another 210% increase in charter school supported schools, while your traditional public schools continue to lag behind. Now that was, in my opinion, purposefully done. Over the 2010 to approximately 2017, you saw a decline in state tuition support from the General Assembly. And then, and only then, when you saw that decline get to its most minimal point, do you see an increase. And so when you ask me about, going back to your question, $1.2 billion, I would love to see where the other side of the aisle would love to spend it. And I'm going to tell you that if we don't start looking at this closely, we're going to find ourselves further behind the eight ball where we are today. The fact that if you look at our traditional public schools and you go to the dashboard that was just created, we have 30% of our kids that are reading, 30% of our children who are reading proficiently and have the math skills in grade 8 in the state of Indiana. That's over 90% of our kids. So yes, we've spent money on K-12 education. We just haven't spent it on the majority of kids that we are under constitutional obligation to support. I want to close by saying this. When we find ourselves in a position like this as a legislature where we have resources, to me, the thing that speaks the loudest is not where we spend the money, but how we spend the money. And let me explain the difference between those things. When it came to creating a AAA bond rate, okay, we spent all of our resources to make sure that we could pay our bills and we had a balanced budget. Well, we've achieved that goal, which means that when we go borrow money, we're going to be able to borrow at the lowest, one of the lowest rates in the country, somewhere less than 2.5%. Yet even the governor's proposal that I believe that the supermajority will support had an $800 million cash infusion into a correctional facility. I want you to think about $800 million and what that would do for K-12 funding. Why have the AAA rating where you can borrow at the best rates if you're not going to leverage that $800 million? In addition, the supermajority over the last year have decided that we're going to pay down our pension fund obligations faster than we have to. And so we started out at 2060. We're down to 2030 that we'll pay off our pension obligations, yet they're taking $2.5 billion cash, that's B, not M, and putting it in a bank account to pay down pension obligations that are not even due yet. And along with the fact that we've already got it to where if we just made our regular payments right now, it would be gone in 2029. So what, we're going to shift it now to 2028 while we're seeing healthcare outcomes that are terrible, 47th in the nation, while our education attainment goals are in the gutter. So for us as Democrats, investing in Hoosiers is important. Not giving $25 million for businesses to create their own childcare facilities on their sites. That's the how. It's not just what, it's how you do it. And we have a different idea on how to do it. We want to put Hoosier taxpayers first and not businesses.